Hi, Sharisha, welcome.
Hi,
Good to see
Vivek.
you. You know,
Yeah.
15 years, I guess.
15 years, yeah.
Almost 15 years.
Yeah.
Sharisha, this whole journey of yours, right? Starting from one thing, so we'll keep it very casual. So though I
Yeah,
have few
absolutely.
questions, though I have few
Yeah.
questions lined up, and areas where I would like students to get some idea on career choices, as well as how see at the age of 21, 22, their perception of the career life is very different than what actually it might turn out to be. So our effort is to make them ready, and they have a lot of aspirations, and they'll still find some hurdles. So how to get over this? So somewhere the objective is aligned to this. But in your intro, I found something very interesting. So when Aditi said that you have been a lifetime scholar, so maybe I'll start with that that you have been a lifetime scholar. So how does that put you in with respect to rest of your peers? Also, does it put a lot of pressure, and how have you handled this? So because it brings some expectations. So let's start with this, and then we'll get start your journey of your life and career. How do you think?
Yeah, sure. So, yeah, in terms of the scholarship and the pressure, I think peer pressure is what you take, right? So, because of a variety of reasons or, whatever I've seen in terms of my own life journey and the teachers I had and what they told me, what I realized is pressure is what you, peer pressure is what you take. I firmly believe that each of us have our own journey and path to follow. And whatever we pick, doing it to the best of our ability. One of my teachers constantly tells me about to be the best that you can be every single day. I think that's what I look forward to. So yeah, so there's no pressure, no expectation. If at all this expectation, I have expectations for myself in terms of what I want to be or how I can get even better.
So best you can be. So when did this, come in your life, and how has it changed your life? Because we see all this, but I think we don't implement it too much.
Yeah, so I've gone through when I was making some of those crucial career decisions. I think I was always very lucky to have a variety of coaches, mentors who've been helping me or asking me the right questions. At every time, whenever you're making that big decision, you have that doubt in your head, right? Am I doing the right thing? Am I leaving a lot on the table? And that's when a teacher, one of my coaches who I was talking to, was actually told me, who was, in fact, if you remember, Professor Raghu Anantanarayanan, who was doing EI course along with Professor Indra Parikh when we were on campus. So he was someone I think I held to even after campus because had a lot of learning from him. And one of the things that he always told me was in life, it's very important. A lot of you all, we'll all face a lot of challenges, go through a lot of things, and everybody has their own journey, right? So the moment you start comparing, no two lives are the same. So you will never get, you'll only start feeling unhappy about where you are because there are always tons of people who are, moving far ahead. And then, so two things that he taught me is how do I define my career journey? And the other part is to be the best that you can be. So he says, pick what you want to do and then strive to make sure you excel. So that started from campus days. And you're absolutely right, very difficult to put it into practice. So I remember one very funny incident. 3 years into working, I joined a big IT giant, and my boss asked me to make a presentation. Now, I think you'll agree, right? When we step out of IMA, we assume we are God's gift to mankind, right? So, we are here to transform the world and all of that. So, I had that attitude, and when I started work, the first thing he said, okay, I want you to make this presentation. And then he started telling me, slide one, I want you to do this. This is what slide two, I want you to talk about this. Slide three, I want you to talk about this. I told him, look, I have my own head. So, you tell me what you want, I'll work on the presentation. So he said, no. He said, this is something you're doing it for the first time, and I will tell you, and this is how you will learn. I somehow it hit me on the wrong side. And I said, you know what? I can think and do a lot of things. Why is he asking me to do all of this? So I just blindly noted on whatever he said. And you won't believe, I made a pure black and white presentation, okay? Just putting verbatim what he told me. And I sent it to him. So he called me to his room, to his cabin. And he said, okay. I said, come, you know, write your obituary. So I was shocked. Why is he asking me to do this? So he said, write your obituary. I said, why? He said, do you know what obituary means? I said, yeah, you write it for people who are dead. He said, write your obituary. I want you to write three things that you want people to remember you for. You know, because people write about good things that they remember about you, but it should be those uniform qualities that everybody will see. So then I wrote few things that I wrote about being passionate, being hardworking, and giving the best that I can give for anything. He said, keep these three things in mind, stick them in front of you, and you should show that in everything you do, even if it's the smallest of chores. So that hit me really hard, because that's great, right? To actually say that, you know, everything that you want to do, you need to show what are those values or what are those qualities that you stand for.
Right.
So to date, I mean, it's 14 years and he's still one of my very good friends and mentors and keeps guiding me. But this is, to me, that was like the turning point where I actually started implementing and I consciously started thinking about what is it that I should do to be the best in what I can do. And the more you start practicing, I think very soon it evolved into every day. I think, okay, what is the best that I can do today? Because no 2 days are the same, right? There's some days you're low on energy. There's some days you're just not in the frame of mind to do. But given that, what is the best that you can do in that particular day is what I look for.
We'll come to that later, Sirisha. That is one set of questions which you are handling, that how do you handle the days when you don't are high on energy. But let's try to understand your life journey. Okay.
Okay.
Two parts. You know, one is your life journey. You know, how, you know, from maybe someone who was a spirited young achiever and you walked into, you know, doors, corporate doors, and how you faced some challenges and how you encountered those challenges. And then maybe we'll come to the professional journey. So can you just give us, you know, your key milestones or lessons in your life journey, and you know, how have you taken the life, what life brought on your way, and how you and what you made out of you, and why you are the person you are, you know, today. You know, maybe, you know, it will be a real eye opener.
Sure, I'll do that. So I was born, brought up in Hyderabad. Had a very interesting childhood. I was always a topper academically, and I was always very active in athletics. And so for me, life was like fun, and I used to do a lot of, I used to have a lot of fun in school, but I was always liked by the teachers because of the way I was balancing both and all of that. So suddenly when I was 13 years old, I had fever for a couple of days, and suddenly I couldn't move my left hand. Okay, which was totally shocking because we didn't know what happened. So then they admitted me to the hospital, a variety of things and tests and all. Within 6 hours, I realized I can't move my right hand. And that was a shock. So they immediately shifted me to the ICU. Nobody was knowing what was happening. Doctors were not able to figure out because my fever was normal. I was talking, I was conscious, everything. But then this happened. Then next was where they, within 6 hours, so they took me to the hospital and they said, you know what, let's scan her entire body to see what's going wrong. And I got up and then I collapsed. And that's it. My legs, my back, everything was gone. So everything under my neck was totally paralyzed. Now that was totally shocking. Doctors didn't know what was going on. And after some time, they put me in ICU because they said you could get into some complications. And then they realized that there was some amount of respiratory trouble that could possibly happen. And when that, so they put me into the ICU for 2 months. I was in the ICU. After about 45 days, they diagnosed that it was something called...
How old were you? With 11?
13. After 45 days, they finally diagnosed that it could be a variant of a very unique disease called spinal meningitis, where the meninges, the layer surrounding your spinal cord, get infected because of a virus So nobody knows why, what, and nobody knows how to handle it also. So 60 days into the, and so they were expecting that the organs will start getting affected, which is why I was put in the ICU, but I was awake, conscious, and went through a variety of things those 2 months. And at the end of 60 days, doctors pronounced their judgment saying good news and bad news. Good news, she's alive. Okay, bad news is nothing can happen. I mean, you know, she can't recover because this is irreversible. So then we came back, but my dad is a sports person all through. So my dad said, nothing doing. Who are they to say that, you know, it's not recoverable. We'll start working on it. And we did enormous amount of physiotherapy. And in fact, that academic year, I passed because of already having, I got promoted to the next year because I had good academic average so far. And next year, even when I was not able to walk, my dad used to actually pick me and take me to school. Just pick me in his hands, take me to school, make me sit, listen to the classes. And evening, we used to do physiotherapy. And made me do so much that I recovered. Even till date, the doctors, I mean, I'm still in touch with all the doctors who've treated me. And for them, I'm a miracle. So that probably was like a big lesson in life, lesson in resilience, right? And that taught me my first, probably very important lesson, which probably I think I realized it as a lesson much later on in life. But it taught me that whether you're breathing or not is an issue. Everything else is not. So sometimes when, you know, probably after having gone through all of this, I realized when people get mentally disturbed for really small things, when people, you know, go to the extent of taking their own lives for small things, then realize, just remember, every life will go through a lot of twists and turns, but, you know, whether you're breathing or not is the real issue for which you don't have too much control. Everything is a problem, and every problem will have its own solution. You just have to figure it out. So that was my first lesson. My second lesson in terms of career journeys, right? So, life journey. My second lesson in terms of my life journey was when I went to Ahmedabad. I think you'll also relate to it. I mean, the moment you get in there, that's a totally different environment. Enormous amount of pressure, enormous amount of work that people are doing, lots to study. And for me, going to Ahmedabad was the first time I was living in a hostel. So for me, everything was different. Right? Until then, I was studying at Hyderabad, and suddenly I go live in a hostel, and I'm seeing there's never-ending amount to study, and I'm just getting lost. So my first term, and all, you know, always I've been a, like, post my illness also, I was my state topper in 12th, and I was my university topper all my 3 years in grad, 4 years in graduation, all of that. So then when I came to campus, so now, you know, here you're coming with the mindset that, you know, it's you're just looking at getting back to your A game, right? And I got totally lost. So I ended up with a few C's and a few B's. So for me, that was hitting me hard. So if you remember first year, first term, actually, we were allowed to pick mentors. We could go to reach out to professors to actually, you know, ask them to mentor you or help you sail through that first year, right? So there was one favorite professor of mine, Professor Koshi. She used to teach brand management. So Koshi sir was my mentor. And I said, you know, I'm kind of disturbed. I think I'll just walk out. You know, I don't think this is what I can do. And so he said, okay, come over to my house for a cup of coffee. So I went in, and then he listened to all my rants, and he asked me about my academic journey, you know, what I learned and all of that. So I was telling him, yeah, I did this. I was talking more about how I fared academically. And so then Koshi sir asked me, why did you join IMA? So I said, yeah, good job, better career prospects and all of that. So he said, but that you will probably get it through other institutes also. Why IMA? So then I told him that, you know, there's a lot to learn here, and, you know, there good professors, there's so much, there's access to so much infrastructure, so much that we can learn all around us. So he said, but you never know what is learning. What you've always been doing is only studying. I don't think you've learned anything at all in your life.
Wow.
So that hit me. That actually got me thinking. I said, what do you mean? So then he was saying, you know, let me explain the difference about what is studying and what is learning. So he said, studying clearly is where you're doing with an objective. Ye padhna hai to achieve this. Okay. So for you, you've always defined the studying as to achieve something. But learning is lifelong.
Right.
You know, it's there all around. It's about what you absorb. Nothing in learning goes waste. Tell me one thing you did that did not help you in your, one thing that you actually tried learning till date, which was not part, something that contributed to you academically.
Right.
So no, you've always been only studying. You've been studying with a goal. You've never learned. So this is an institute where people come to learn.
Right.
Wow. For me, that was transformational because I realized how wrongly we benchmark success. You know, success as a student, we very wrongly benchmark success as a student about your academic numbers, you know, the marks and percentages that you get. Success later on in life in the corporate world about the money you make. But these are probably two really wrong measures.
Correct.
You know, or these are very, I wouldn't even say wrong measures. These are probably very unidimensional measures that we are assigning to it.
Right.
And he said, you have to learn. You have to, you know, come be open to learn. If you don't understand something, take 10 days to learn it. It doesn't matter. You don't have to do it in 2 days because the rest of your batch is doing it in 2 days. Like I never had accounting background, right? So Menac was like a nightmare for me. Then Quant was a nightmare for me. But I used to thoroughly enjoy operations management. I used to enjoy a few other subjects. So then he said, the areas that you're not knowing, if you're passionate about learning, just sit and learn. Walk out to one prof who will say no if you go and ask them for something. You have access to Vikram Sarabhai Library, and that's probably the best resources that you could find. So that was again a big lesson, because I think post my first term, I marks were happening. Marks were coming, going. There were some very good ones. There were not so good ones. But I focused on actually spending a lot of time learning. That helped, because for me, I used to spend a lot of time in the library. And, you know, I think the big joke in my dorm was, if you have to find Sirisha first, search in the library. And if you don't find her there, then you can come to a room. So that's how it was. So that was like second big lesson, you know, about learning. Learning is lifelong. And prepare yourself to learn forever. That's what is going to keep you active, mentally active. You know, always have that passion, that looking forward to waking up with excitement every day.
Which is very visible in the number of courses you end up doing, and you know how your career shaped up from there. So you know, compare most of the typical B school careers. The way they flow, they get into corporate, they start achieving heights. Maybe by 30s, late 30s, they have started, fighting for the CXO roles. And, versus you have, focused on learning and, pursued, different set of courses and create your own niche. Okay.
Yeah.
So, I think that had such a huge impact,
That actually helps me right now, even at work, because there are multiple things that I can talk about with comfort.
Right.
You know, having seen different areas, worked in different areas. So it's that's what also helps me. So that actually got me to make sure that every alternate year I invest significant amount of time learning on a course. And every year, most of my measures are in terms of what have I learned.
Oh, wow.
Picking up areas that are totally outside of work. It could be art, it could be music, it could be anything, but just trying to learn something.
What are you learning now?
I'm actually experimenting on learning all the 8 Indian art forms, which are, the Patachitra, the drawing art forms. We have Madhubani, we have Varli, we have Patachitra, we have Tanjore paintings. So I'm attempting to learn those.
Yeah. You sure are?
One of the other things, apart from the work-related learning that I'm doing, some things that I'm working on, this is one thing that I'm looking at exploring this year. Yeah.
Brings me to the next area where, a lot of students also have an interest. Two things. One is how the idea, the seed of, you know, pursuing an MBA came into mind. Okay. And then because it was a technical shift also for you, from you were not from a commerce background. Okay. And from, you know, being, let's say, engineering graduate, you know, to the whole idea of, you know, being into this HR and this leadership coaching, you know, how did this journey happen and how fruitful has this been? You know, so, you know, generally maybe your life, you know, milestones, your career, you know, how it has shaped, because that will also give an idea how, you know, beautifully careers can be shaped, you know, especially, you know, to a lot of young women who have joining us or who would be watching this video later, you know. So from that perspective also, plus the idea that, you know, MBA, the career journey itself, you know, students should have an idea where they are going. You know, actually, I'll also like to know.
Yeah. So okay, two things first, right? One, journey is always in hindsight. Okay. All of these are decisions I took at different points in time. These are choices I made. Okay. So when I look back the 15 years, it looks like journey. Now, today, whatever decisions I take in the next 2-3 years is not something that I plan as a roadmap or a journey, but, you know, decisions at that point in time. So I think all choices we make depend on the circumstances at that point in time, in your context, right? So that's how these decisions happen. So so you're talking about my shift from computer science to MBA. I'll tell you a shift even before that. So I always aspired to be a doctor. Okay. You know, in fact, if I have to actually say, when I was in my fourth or fifth standard, I used to sign off as head neurosurgeon, FRCS London. Okay. So that used to be my aspiration. I always wanted to be a neurosurgeon. And so I was pursuing medicine. Now, even when I fell ill and all, everybody said I could go into physician side of it. So I was pursuing and then got admitted into a medical school. Okay, one of the best medical schools I've got the admit to. And then after a few months, I was sent back because they said from that year, surgery was compulsory. And, you know, you need 100% physical health to be a surgeon. So I was sent back. So for me, that was like a big disappointment. Okay, now disappointment, getting over it is one part of it. The next part was, okay, what do I do next? Right. So always focused on sciences. After 10th, I never studied maths. And even through the school, right, maths was there, but I was always focused on sciences. So then what do I do? So then there was a, so then I had to said, OK, let me do bachelor's computer science. So let me figure out how I'll do it. And then I started learning programming. I joined probably 4 months before. I joined college 4 months before the first year exams, because, you know, I already joined the medical school. I spent some time there. After 3-4 months, I was out. Then I had to figure out where I'll join. I had to figure out where I'll get an admit, who will give me an admit into something in a field that I don't even have. So in a small college, I got my admit and all of that. So then started studying. So programming seemed interesting. So did bit of it. So I remember the first year, I wrote the exam. Nobody even knew me in the college, right? Because I joined like 4 months before. So they thought, ye, kahin se toh aayi hai types. So, and I was lost. Didn't know ABC of programming. So I was like sitting day and night trying to learn programming on my own, because a lot of the teaching was already done in college. And the results came and they said, somebody from this college topped the university. And that was me. So for me, that became a turning point. Then I think by then I realized that if I put my heart and soul to it, I can do it. And I think that's the same for all of us, right? So when you know that this is what you want to do, you make sure you're giving it your best and doing it. So then went on, so studied there. Now, even there, because it was computer science, a lot of programming and stuff, but I didn't do quant. Then it came, you know, when I was in my final year, was the decision, I had to make the decision of whether I wanted to do an MBA or do higher studies in computer science. And a lot of talking, my brother was already studying at IIM Bangalore then. So, you know, talking to him, you know, finding out, and probably I think the life journey, all the experiences I went through, right, I had heightened level of self-awareness. I knew what I'm good at, what I can do, what I can't do. So that's when I said, okay, let me go for an MBA. Now I had 10 months to write CAT. And I remember my first quant, first the mock CAT that you usually take before you start, right? I had like abysmal scores. I still remember the numbers. So can I share those numbers?
Yeah.
Yeah. My quant was 5 out of 50. Okay. My verbal was 30. My reading comprehension was around 35. And my data interpretation, I got 7. So that was a 200 mark paper. All these scores were out of 50. Okay. So I said, where am I going to even land with this? So then worked hard. Worked really hard, and I know what I mean, because it was like, you know, you sleep at around 11:30, 12, wake up at 4:30 again and study, because you have a day college to complete, the college work to finish, and then also prepare. You know, it was, I was doing it along with my final year, so there was a lot of work that was going on there also. And towards the end, quant happened to be my strongest area. I did fairly well, probably. I think I was the only person from AP to get through all the 6 IIMs then. Right. So bottom line of actually saying this is, it can't get, this course can't get, I think, worse than this, right? When I started off.
Yeah.
So it's all possible. I think it's all doable. It's just about putting your heart and soul into what you want to do.
So once, you know, so I wanted to understand, see, from IMA, this portfolio of coaching you have created. So, you know, you can take through that journey from, you know, passing through MBA, how these decisions made, what came in your life. You know, you might have taken some interesting choices, you know, and, you know, taken this career route. You know, so how how rewarding the career has been, and how the choices you made, you know, somewhere on the way.
Yeah. So I think choices I made, I was always, I think if I look back, I don't regret on anything, because they were all choices I made. So first thing is, you know, me making my own decisions, right? Or what I want to do, not because of something else. So started off as a banker, did very well there, was doing very well there. And after a year or so, I realized, you know, that's not the grind that I want to go through. Because as a person, I was always doing a variety of things, and that's what kept me sane. You know, I was pursuing something or the other outside of just the core studies also. So I had some hobbies, and I used to invest time reading. So banking didn't give me the chance. I was working almost 14 hours, 15 hours a day. Again, right? Because there, I wanted to do the best that I can do there, which is where I used to spend really long hours working. And that's when I was also getting married. So then that was the choice that I made, that I will switch, you know, and moved into consulting in a tech firm. And so that was one, my first choice, decision that I made then. Very simple. I was not getting that kind of work-life balance that I wanted. I completely enjoyed my job. I think whatever I learned there was my biggest first work lessons, right? You know, everything about your work ethics, to getting things done on time, to managing yourself. Learned a lot there, but I realized that's not my cup of tea. So that's when I moved to consulting in tech firm. Then got married. Consulting was very good in the sense that I could also, because I had my earlier tech farm science background, right? And the business acumen part that I gained in while working in a bank, that banking, so in the banking financial services, I started working as a consultant. Learned a lot there, did that for quite some time. But consulting is where it's very dynamic world, right? Where you're always on the move, and there are lots of things that are coming and going and all of that. So amount of work pressure, or, you know, you're always working with 3 clients trying to figure out which one is going to materialize for the company and all of that. So consulting worked well. Then had 2 kids. So in between, I think I was very lucky to work with a nice firm where whenever I was taking breaks to study, I was always investing time to study. That's when I did my mind mapping certification. That's when Stanford design thinking happened, all of that. Then I realized after my second kid was born, I realized consulting, by then I was already managing a huge team of consultants. I was leading a practice. So then I realized consulting, you know, being on the move all the time with kids at home is not something that I would want to do. And, you know, you are a senior consultant, you're pushing your team to go travel and get things done. And you're saying, I'm not going to move because I need to take care of my family. It was not a right thing to do, right? So that's when I was looking at what next. So while I was consulting, I was also program managing large engagements. The biggest team size I managed was close to about 463 people with, you know, more than $500,000 P&L. So that's where, when I was managing that, I realized my USP was the way I was handling my teams. My USP was the way my team was always the happiest, and there was zero attrition, nobody leaving my team, and they were all very happy. That was my way of getting things done from people. And that also got me very interested in, you know, the people part of it. And I realized, you know, large teams, big corporates, what differentiates one team from another team? It's all the same type of people that the company takes in, right? But what differentiates a successful unit versus a not so successful unit is how do you get things done from the team. So I realized that people are crux to what any organization does. And after the real capital, right, the real money, it's the human capital that matters, because all strategies, all marketing, everything that you have in place is all fine as long as you have great people to execute. That got me interested in people. So when I was looking at, you know, consulting is where I don't want to take it further, at least for some time as a consultant in the company. I didn't want to take it at that time because my kids were small and they needed my attention. They needed me to be, you know, I wanted to be around them, you know, not miss their growing years. So that's where I took that call of leaving consulting and moving into the people side of things. So the advantage I had by then already was, so within the same company I took this move, the advantage I had was I understood what the business wants, and I had done design thinking and other things. So I knew what is needed to make work in the people area transformational. And that's where even I moved to learning and development, leadership development and coaching, which is where I was actually doing something called outcome-based consulting for business units within the company. So any business unit, they say, this is our problem. This is what we need to get done. I was helping them, making sure they're getting things done. So that's how that shift into L&D and learning and development and leadership development and coaching happened. So that was a journey in itself, because I had to start learning everything from scratch.
What is this coaching? And what is coaching, and how would you tell these students, I think it's a very upcoming field, and it really has a lot of impact on, you know, the performance. So, you know, how rewarding has been coaching for you? What is coaching? And, you know, generally, how should, you know, young executives or people who are getting in career, you know, even maybe for our batchmates also, you know, if that could be a good advice. How should one approach this?
Yeah. So this whole space of learning and development, leadership development, right, is actually fast evolving. Okay. Earlier point in time, it was all about, it was very operational, very transactional, the way it's being done. Now, over the last 5 years, I think it's phenomenal, 5 to 10 years, actually, phenomenal amount of evolution in the way people are actually looking at this, and how it is going to impact the business. Earlier, it was a checklist. Now people actually do all of this to create an impact on the business. And in terms of coaching, the best part about it is it's very gratifying, right? You are actually helping a person. It's not just about talking, but you're actually helping a person or a business unit, a business leader, get his team along and take them through a journey that's going to make them reach the next milestone. So for me, in terms of the reward, it's been extremely gratifying. You can actually see the change that you're making. And I'm sure, like, you know, as teachers, you all will probably see that, right? Where you're taking children through that journey of 1 year, 1.5 years that they're associated with you. And then they get to somewhere. That's very gratifying. So that's the level of gratification that I find in this, which is very different from getting the gratification when you're growing businesses. Both are two separate things, right? So this gratification is actually doing with people, and you form real strong bonds with people. So that's been very rewarding. What is coaching? Coaching is helping someone go from point A to point B without you giving the answers, but actually helping them discover the answers. And no two journeys are the same. So a coach doesn't go with a set process of ye problem hai, ye solution hai, ye le lo, follow kar lo. That's not how it works. You need to help that person, because in coaching, you're actually helping that person transform. Their whatever they start doing is their choice and is going to become their way of life. So you can't give your way of life or your choices to them and say, this is what you should do. So you never give any solutions, answers in coaching. And I benefited a lot through coaches all along. You know, we wouldn't have called it coaching or whatever, right? Right. But right from very early age, you know, you always had someone who would guide you, who would help you reflect, who would help you become more self-aware. And like I told you about my life journey, right? There are a lot of times when you needed someone to ask you those tough questions. A coach also asks you those tough questions. Coach also helps you reflect, introspect to get your deepest fears outside, where you're actually addressing your deepest fears. So some successful coaching journeys are where you actually let that person reflect to get to their deepest fears and get them out, which actually helps them in their journey. So it's very personal, very different. I benefited a lot through coaches all along, even today. For different things, I have different coaches I constantly work with, because they help you grow.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So very interesting. So you are an MBA couple.
Yeah.
Can you say that? You know. So yeah. How has career being a career mom and to an extent career dad? You know, how do you balance it? And you know, who is it tough for? Is it tough for you, or is it tough for your partner? How does it go?
So the best part is, okay, so I met my husband during the B School Fest conference at IMA, and he was also an MBA. He'd come to visit, attend that festival, and that's how I met. And the best part about, so we got married pretty soon after that. So, you know, we've literally been growing together, growing through our career together. And I think what works best is we striking a balance. So there are different times when, you know, my decisions, choices that I was making became important, where, you know, he was making sure he's there with the kids. And there are times when I needed to make sure I give him that adequate support. So he's an entrepreneur. He has his own company now. In 2010, he moved into entrepreneurship. And that's when, so I think we've struck that good balance. So we have now have a 14-year-old and a 10 and a half year old. So I think it's all about striking the balance. It's all about mutual respect. It's all about giving each other's space.
You're not taking a stand. You're saying it's almost, you know, equal.
It's equal. It got to be equal. And that's why it's called a balance, right? Otherwise, because at any point you don't want any, you know, either one to actually feel that they've left something behind for somebody else. I think, like I was saying earlier, right? Everything you make is choices you make in life. So for instance, I remember when he was moving into entrepreneurship, that was when our young one was really small. And I had an option to actually travel to UK for 6 months. And then I said, no, I'm not doing that. Because I knew he was getting into entrepreneurship, and he was literally working for 14, 16 hours a day. So at that time, if I travel, then who will take care of the kids? So it's all about striking balance. It's all about, the trust and mutual respect. So, yeah.
Couple of quick questions, Sirisha. One is, this is something, since I mentor students over across time and, who have successfully done MBA, okay, and we have a reasonable strong percentage as far as gender diversity is concerned in our system as well as in students. So, is there a typical gender bias in corporate India? How does, these young women, manage this, if there it is? How do, as a woman, they go about managing their career and life? Any specific advice to, them? Because I would like that angle to be there, because that's a, there is a glass ceiling also attached somewhere. And it's not very easy when you are, balancing these two, three steps, which are kind of you want to do. Okay. It's not that you don't want to do. Plus, there are expectations also, So, what would be your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So, two, three quick things. I think one, ask for help when you need. Okay. So, that could be at work, that could be this. Just voice out and not struggle. You don't have to do it all. Okay, so you can ask for help, seek out, reach help to make sure you do what you want to do. Second, be very clear about what you want to do. I think, with all talks around diversity and inclusion, whatever I have seen in corporates, now when I work outside with corporates as an outsider and when I was in the corporate world, I think if you're very clear about what you want to do and how you want to do it, in terms of, what is your aspiration? Where do you want to reach? You have ways of doing it. Corporates today are slowly starting to become flexible. Like, for instance, I know when my kids were small, for a job that was supposed to always done in office, I got the permission to actually work from home because I needed to be around. So corporates are becoming very flexible, but you have to ask for it. Nobody will never become the victim, get into that, victimizing mentality where you're waiting for someone to offer support, ask for help when you need it. And be very clear, you can't do it all. So don't have guilt pangs. And at any point, like I've been talking all through, right? Every stage is a choice you make. So for every choice, there's some wins and there's some things that you lose. So be very conscious of that. Don't need to get into guilt because of it.
So now you're talking a very heightened sense of self-awareness, So how does one get this self-awareness throughout? Maybe, we are talking about three times in this conversation, and this is something which we try to, pass to students. Maybe it's, they will reach their, in their journey some point of time. Okay. And, but it comes naturally. So, generally, how does one, ensure, like someone like you who have seen maybe so many struggles from your childhood, which did impact your career decisions also. So you wanted to be, to an extent, pursue medicine from, getting into, coding, then pursuing MBA to getting into, banking, to getting into consulting, to pursuing HR, to doing leadership coach, to being a, I have two such beautiful, kids and managing family and lovely life, this would require a lot of self-awareness and setting yourself, the right goals and the things you should, are the right or the clutter in your head. Now, how does one go about this process?
So, okay, I can only tell what worked for me.
Yeah.
Constant reflection. And when you're reflecting, it has to be brutal. Okay. It's like somebody else dissecting you, right? It has to be brutal. Saying, yeah, this is wrong, this is right. That's where coaches help me a lot. Because it's dispassionate judgment, right? You're in coaching, what happens is you reach out to the coach. So when you reach out to the coach, you're saying, yes, I need help. And that's why they're free to ask you all brutal questions. So the coaches help me a lot. And I constantly do a lot of reflection. I have lofty dreams always. Okay. So that lofty dreams generally sets the direction. So small setbacks, all of that happen. But my dreams are so lofty that these setbacks seem smaller in the bigger picture of things. And this too shall pass because that's where I want to reach. So I think those two things for me have constantly helped me pick myself back whenever I have had setbacks, so you know, whenever you fall down, you keep picking yourself up. That's happened a lot of times, right? A lot of failures, a lot of times that happens when you keep falling down, but you pick yourself up and you see what you learn from that. And because you know that there is a bigger goal. So when that dream gets, you know, larger, right, then fear slowly starts to disappear. So
but how do you, this third party, is there a process? Do you make a blog or do you, you know, talk to coaches, you know, and
I shamelessly reach out to people.
Timeline, maybe a month or a quarter or something like this. How does it work for you?
I shamelessly reach out to people asking for help when I need help. And I'm very clear with them. See, this is what I want to learn from you. This is where I think I struggle today. This is what I learned from you, want to learn from you. So can you help? Barring two or three here and there, I don't think nobody ever said no. Okay, because you have to be, so it's, I think they also look for somebody who wants to be genuine. For instance, today, lots of people reach out to me and I have never said no to anyone. It becomes outside of my work hours. I go out of my way to do, figure out. Don't go and ask, ki mujhe naukri dilao. At least that's what was my motto. I never go and ask people, get me this project or, you know, get me this job. I've not done that. I've always gone to learn something from them. But the kind of questions that they have asked every time, it just keeps enriching you. You know, every time somebody asks you a question, there's always something that you learn something or you've not thought it in that way and you'll start doing differently. And that coach need only someone. For me, you know, the conversations, sometimes the conversations I have with my husband are like that. I say, you know what? You're very good at this. Can you help me in this? So that's just, I think that's what I said, right? Shamelessly reach out for help and know what you want help for and reach out, and that helps.
Very interesting talking to you, Shirisha. I will just sum my learnings or your life lessons from you in the 5 points which I am able to get. And then maybe ask you some few one-word questions and pass it to Aditi, and Aditi then can take questions from students. So, you know, one is, continuous learning. Okay. That one has to be into continuous learning. Two, though you have not said specifically, but, you know, go with the flow, be open for opportunities, what come to your way, because you like journey somewhere is across that. Three, be the best you can be. You know, four, you know, ask for help. Okay. And perseverance, and you know, give your best shot, you know, because whatever comes into it, because you know, so more or less these five should strike a balance. You try to strike a balance to add another one. So I think this is what I have gained. Thanks a ton. But quickly before we move to Aditi, you know, three books you recommend to us.
One is Factfulness by Hans Rosling. That's something that impacted me a lot. Then Power of Habit, Charles Duhigg, you know, all about habit building and doing the right things. Then a whole lot of podcasts that I constantly listen to, like you know, Vijay Fogg and Guy Kawasaki and Simon Sinek and all of them. So each of them have written a whole ton of books. And what I realized with podcasts is you get the gist of that book through the podcast in 20 to 30 minutes. So some of those are absolutely wonderful that keep making you think, reflect. Yeah.
How do you catch news?
Least interested. It's News Today. This is called News Today. There's some specific sites that I go and read for work, for general update on what's happening in the business world, but no.
Right. And how do you plan to retire, or you don't plan to retire?
I don't plan to retire.
Yeah.
I love my work, so
I think that is enough. Thanks a lot, Shirisha. Very, very, very positive interaction, and I really learned a lot from you. And Aditi can take the question.
It was a pleasure talking. Yeah.